But something strange happens because when I went into the dining room, I started to feel like my spirit was starting to separate from my body. I felt a heavy separation between my body and my spirit. And now I was screaming. My siblings and my cousins who were going to sleep at the house begin to scream as well. So now the environment gets chaotic now. I'm screaming that I'm dying. I'm separating from my body. Somebody help me. I'm separating. I'm dying. Hi, my name is Tshegofatso Tshweumbuyamba. Many call me Tshegofatso. I will be turning 33 this year. I was born in Limpopo province at a community called Radikhali. I'm from a family of three girls and I'm the firstborn. Currently, I reside in Johannesburg in Bramley. I am a wife and a mother to two absolutely gorgeous boys. And my husband is from DRC. So today I'm here to share my story of how witchcraft almost destroyed my life. I basically did my tertiary education in Johannesburg. So in 2009, during the mid-year holidays, I had traveled home just like any other student would. And during that time, my great-grandmother had passed away. May her soul rest in peace. And I remember on that day, you know, I think it was a Friday, you know, when you come from Limpopo, you know, on the Friday, there's always that peeling that needs to take place. And I didn't feel like going, but my mother was like, no, man, you have to go. You know, she thought I was being snobbish. You know, at the time, I came from a community where not a lot of people were, you know, given the opportunity to go to university. So I was quite privileged. You know, just to mention in brackets as well that also God came through for me with regards to my education, because I've never paid for any of my degrees. And as of today, I have two degrees and multiple certificates that I've fully sponsored. I've never paid for any. And also, just to carry on with the story now, is that so my mother was like, you have to go. I mean, you're back at home. All the other cousins will be there, and, you know, and they're going to look at me like I have a rebellious child. And I said, okay, it's fine, because you're my mom and I honor you, I will come. So I took my small knife, because everybody has to come with their own one. And I went there, you know, in rural communities, you know, one surname would have like four houses in the surrounding. So my great-grandmother's house and my grandmother's house were not far from each other, because my mother actually later in life moved to Rakama. That's where now that's my mom's house. So Radikhali is now my grandmother's place. So I went to my great-grandmother's place, to pardon me for that, and I found a group of my cousins and some of the ladies from the community, and we were busy peeling, and I got there late, so they were just about to finish, and they were preparing for us to have some scones, and I was like, you know, I wasn't really feeling them. So I saw my cousin just passing by with a plate of pap and chicken, and I said, can I have that? And she was like, yeah, sure. So she explained to me where to get it. You know, I'm going to jump a few steps so that we can get to the deepness of the story. So I quickly went over to where, you know, the elderly women were. They were cooking pap to try and get you know, a piece for myself. And when I arrived there, I wanted to reach out to a specific pot, but there was this old lady there. She said to me, no, don't get the pap from that pot. I want you to get it from that specific pot. And I thought, okay, it's fine. You know, they're the ones that cook, they know what they're doing. So I grabbed the pap from there and I went into where the chicken was, and my mother was next to there. So I put the chicken into my plate and I began to eat. But as soon as I started eating, something odd happens. And I say to my mom, possibly I was soft because my mother said she couldn't hear me. I said to her, there's something wrong with this pup. You know, and I took a few bites, maybe two or three, and I said, I can't finish this food. The pap tasted like I was eating raw muti, you know, like muti combined. It was just weird. And I said, I can't eat this. And obviously, because in the first place, I was not interested in being in this place, I said to my mother, I'm going home. We are done anyway. And she said, okay, it's fine. So I rushed quickly to go home, and I was hungry. I don't know whether it's a coincidence, my aunt who had stayed at the house had cooked pap and chicken, the same food, right? And I said, I'm hungry, and they made me food. I ate and I enjoyed the food. So now I believe that that muti that I ate in the pap was beginning to work now, because I started to have, you know, series of events that are now unfolding in the story that are happening. You know, shortly after eating the food, I said, I want to sleep. You know, I change into my sleeping clothes, and At the time, what I did was I went into the bedroom and I picked up my phone and I called my partner who was in Joburg at the time, and I appreciated him. I said, listen, I appreciate you so much. You're such an amazing man. You treat me so well. You know, I said all the things, but I said it in a deeper way, you know, almost like I was saying my goodbye to this person. And I was like, oh, okay, he's my partner. That's okay. I think what shocked me with this, because I called a few friends, was that when I called my father, you know, my father, didn't really raise me, but later when I turned 14, he introduced himself to me, and we have a healthy relationship now. So I called my dad and I said, I appreciate you. I also said my goodbyes with him, and I appreciated him, and I thought that this is getting out of hand now. You know, why am I calling people and why am I telling people and thanking them for their presence in my life? You know, I thought, you know what, I don't know what's going on. Anyway, it's fine. I want to sleep now. So now this muti was starting to work now, so because I felt like going to bed immediately, and it's around maybe 7:30 to 8. So I right in front of this bedroom, my grandmother's bedroom, that's where I went. There was a mirror right in front of me, and I looked at myself in the mirror, and I saw my face transition. I looked at myself, and I saw this beautiful woman that I've never seen, you know, and something convinced me that I was the most beautiful woman, you know, on earth or in South Africa. I just felt beautiful. And then I looked at myself, I had this strange glow, and I was like, what's going on, you know? But I was young, you know. I was like, maybe, you know, I'm just pretty. I laid down, you know, on the bed, and I immediately had a voice, you know, on my right hand ear, and it said, "Utlotlokofala today." And you know, that's Sepedi, and in English it means you are dying today. And it felt so real and convincing. So I immediately jumped out of bed, and now in my mind, the events that happened that led to that were convincing me that now it's happening. You know, you said your goodbyes, you looked at yourself and you're like, wow, I look amazing. You know, I had this piece that didn't make sense. So I rose from the bed to the dining rooms because I wanted to call my siblings to quickly run and call my mom to explain to her that, listen, today's the day that, you know, my days on earth have been numbered. But something strange happens, because when I went into the dining room, I started to feel like my spirit was starting to separate from my body. I felt a heavy separation between my body and my spirit. And now I was screaming. My siblings and my cousins who were going to sleep at the house began to scream as well. So now the environment gets chaotic now. I'm screaming that I'm dying. I'm separating from my body. Somebody help me. I'm separating. I'm dying. And now they quickly jump street. Like I said, the houses are connected. So they quickly jump street to call my mom. And there was a van that quickly came with my cousins. My uncle, you know, and one of my uncles, you know, he always screams. He was like, what's going on? I'll kill someone. What's going on? He was just like screaming, not understanding. At that particular time, my spirit is lifting, is getting all the way to my knees now. As it's getting there, I'm screaming. My mother is also starting to cry. Everybody's confused because I left the funeral place okay. But now I'm all of a sudden there's a chaos. The atmosphere is charged with tears and people are screaming. It doesn't make sense. Again, I had another voice, and I thank God that, you know, I was able to tap into the spirit. You know, I got born again at a very young age, but I left Christianity. I was not, at that time when this incident happened, I was not committed to the Lord. But then I knew prayer, I knew what it means to be born again. So I had another voice mentioning the name of the institution where I was starting, saying that it is over between you and this institution. Something in me said, this death is not from God. Why would this death be connected to my university? And I begged my family, I said, let's pray. So we all hold hands together, and I said, in the name of Jesus, I refuse to die. In the name of Jesus, I'm not dying today. In the name of Jesus, I'm not gonna die. I refuse to die, because I've heard, you know, pastors at the local church at the university where I used to go on a Sunday, but I was not committed. I used to hear them when they pray against the spirit of death, what they would say, and I prayed the same prayer. I said, in the name of Jesus, I refuse to die. And while we were praying together in unity as a family, you know, my spirit started coming back, and I felt like, okay, I'm not, that thing is not separating from me. But it was a heavy separation that I think even words are not doing it justice. I felt a heavy separation of my body and my spirit. And what surprised me is that my body was not getting cold, and I knew that this is not a normal death. This is not a death where people experience, you know. So shortly after we prayed, they moved me into a room. I now begin to sweat, sweating as though they put gallons of water all over my body. And while I'm sweating, I'm shivering, and they can't hold me, like I'm shivering, and the entire family, like, they surround the bed, And I'm in the middle. So they're trying to hold the bed because now, you know, I believe at that time, my body could not handle the fact that my spirit needed to come back, you know, because I defeated premature death. I was shaking, I was sweating, and I couldn't even speak. And I'm crying because I'm like, what did I just experience? I almost died right in front of everybody, you know, and the family now had a meeting to say that this, what is going on here is not normal. I mean, I'm sweating. It's not normal. And this woman needs to leave. So, my aunt's husband said, okay, I'll take her to my house in Teflop, which was not far, maybe about 30 kilometers or so, and or 45. And then he took me to his house. When we got to the house, you know, as a family now, they can see that I'm now getting sick. You know, I'm starting to change. They call a local prophet who comes there, and this prophet looks at me and says, this woman has a gift. She's got a gift. This woman, she's got a prophetic gift. When I look at her, I see a gift in her, and you know, and she her gift is quite of great magnitude. Don't let her eat food from anybody. He explains what he explains. I'm not even paying that much attention. He gives me a few things to use, you know, but he leaves. And at night, while we were sleeping as well, I get constant attacks. Now, the spirit of death comes visiting me, and I keep waking up and saying, I'm dying. I keep waking up and saying, it's coming again. And then another meeting was held now, you know, now to say that tomorrow morning, we have to go to Joburg. I mean, things are happening so fast. So another meeting was held. My mother said, okay, fine, I will not attend the funeral. My daughter and I will journey first thing in the morning. I tell you, we're at Bolokwane first, the first taxi. We were in that taxi, and I'm still sweating, guys. I have this heat on my back all the way going down to my feet. It's not an inexplainable heat. I just have this heat that makes me uncomfortable. So we travel to Joburg. We get to Joburg. Some of my friends we're back. I think it was closer to schools resuming, you know, universities resuming, because some of my friends were there. And they quickly called the local church pastor to say that we have a situation, because people could see that this person is not well. We have a situation. And the church quickly sent a pastor to come and pray for me. And I remember the pastor asking my mom, if you're born again, you know, the story gets me emotional because I remember my mom's words very well. They said to her, are you born again? Because they asked me if I was born again. I said, yes, but I said, I want to rededicate my life to Christ at that particular moment. And my mother said to the pastor, she said, at this moment, I will do anything to see my daughter well. I will do anything. And that broke me. And she I remember her, even after, you know, receiving Christ, my mother was praying and saying to God that, take away this pain from my child and give it to me. She's still so young. Let her leave and let me die. You know, as a firstborn, I had promised my mom that, you know, when God comes through for our education, because I said my mother is a domestic worker, so she didn't have money to take me to university. And when we got the scholarship that I was going, you know, to university, I promised her. You know, I remember I said to her, Mom, when I finish varsity, I'm going to build your house. And by the grace and power of God, I've been able to fulfill that dream. I have done that wish that I promised my mother. Thank God that the Lord kept me alive to fulfill that vision that I had for my mom. And I had promised her that. And my mother, you know, was like, God, let her live. She still had a future ahead of her. You know, I've been given an opportunity that many other people at the time from my community didn't have that opportunity. So, you know, it really pained me. And my mother worked in PE at the time. And she said that the following day we need to go to PE now because I'm sick and she can't leave me in university. I was so blessed. You know, I tell you, when God is in your story, he positions people to come and help you. Destiny help us come at the right time. My friends gathered together. One of them, she said, Mommy, don't take her. I'll look after her. Don't take her. Let her finish her university. And I want to thank God for that friend of mine. And I pray that we have so many people like her that are destiny helpers. She said, no, I'll take care of her. My mother said, are you sure? She said, yes. So she moved over from her dorm to my dorm to come look after me, to stay with me, because, you know, that I had, you know, the enemy doesn't give up. That I had conquered the spirit of death on that Friday did not mean that the devil was going to give up. The spirit of death continued to visit me. So she moved in with me. I remember some nights I would have services where I would wake up and I say, they are here. You know, the spirit is here to fetch me. We would wake up and pray. And my friend used to intercede for almost 3 hours. She would wake up at 3 a.m. when I'm sleeping. I'm in excruciating pain. She would wake up and pray. She would pray for 3 hours. Sometimes I would even leave her, you know, prepared to go get ready for school. And she'd be like, no, I'll come later. You know, where our dorm was, the dorm was at Lyndhurst, but the actual classes were taking place in Joburg. So we used to take a bus. The university had a bus that you would take us every day to school. So sometimes she's like, no, I'll take the late bus. And she would stay praying for me and I would go. But on some instances, we'd go together. I remember this instant where the spirit of death visited me in the bus. The bus was moving and passing like Balfour Park Mall. And, you know, it was about maybe 9 kilometers from the dome. And I said, stop the bus, my friend, stop the bus. It's here. And I was holding it, I said, it's choking me. And people in the bus looked at me like, this woman is lunatic. What's going on? And she said, it's fine, I'll come out with you. You know, we came out of the bus and she walked with me back. We didn't have money for tickets, so we walked all the way back to school. And on that day, I decided that this is too much. I've been going through pain. The spirit of death visited me. I went to the local church, and because now I was a member now. I went to the local church. I lay down on the church that day. The whole day, I begged God to take my life. I will never forget that day. People were coming in to do different things. I was right at the corner. It was a big church. I was right at the corner, and I lay down, and I said, God, take my life. I've been through so much. From being a young girl, you know, I knew from an early age that I was gifted, so I can see things in the spirit. And the people around me, my family didn't see that. And I would say to them, you know, I'm seeing something. You know, I remember one instance, I said, I see a snake outside of the stoop. You know, the houses at home, they have like their own yard and a stoop. I said, I see a snake here. And my uncle is like, where? And he started breaking. And I'm like, I'm seeing it. He's like, he doesn't see it. Also, another time where we were sleeping, I saw something like a black thing on the wall. And I said to them, I'm seeing this thing. And my family said, we don't see anything. But we moved to another room. So they believed me and didn't believe me, because it was confusing them. One thing I've also realized is that the gift of God will not make sense to some of the people around you. The gift of God also has a sense of loneliness in you, that you will have to walk this journey between you and God alone. So fast forward that day, I lie down in the church. I'm begging God to take my life, and he didn't, you know. And come evening, I went back to the institution. I continued to get sick. You know, I remember one time from my belly now, I felt like there was something moving from the right all the way to the left, left all the way to the right. So some days I would miss classes. My friend will bring me books, you know, and notes of what was discussed on the day so I can catch up. So, you know, when such things happen where things are moving, I couldn't go to class. I would call the church again. They'll bring someone to come pray for me. So my dorm was just full of pastors coming in and out, you know, because I was just going through so much. And I'm grateful for the support that they gave me, but it was hell on earth. You know, I knew that defeating that death meant that it's almost like I opened war with the devil head on. You know, at one time as well, my head, I felt like as if I had petrol, it like something oilish. It was going gudum, 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 like there was something inside. And sometimes explaining to people, it was like you're fabricating the stories. I was in so much pain. And also another day, I remember I was lying down in my room, and I was in pain. Now I couldn't move. I was like, I could say bedridden, but it was for like 2 days. And now my roommate at the time, guys, she was getting traumatized. And I remember my roommate says, I can't handle this anymore. You know, she was getting, I could see that this woman is now being affected. There are people coming in the room. There's a sick woman here. We live with another one who was not our roommate, who keeps praying for hours and hours, you know. So I could see that she's really getting affected. So the day that I was on the bed, now it's like I couldn't move. Three of my friends come in, and one lady, she asked me, you know, she said, Tsego, what do you want God to do for you? I said, I want God to take my life right now. Oh, she was flabbergasted. She said, oh, okay. She said, guys, let's just pray, you know. And I could see, you know, that she was just like, oh my God. She didn't expect that answer. I was in so much pain that for me, I felt like death was it for me. I couldn't take it anymore, because there are also moments where I remember one time in a taxi with my partner, we were in a taxi and I saw a vision. It was like vivid. I saw a vision of myself in a casket and I saw my body lying down and there were people surrounding it. I started shaking and didn't understand what was going on. And I couldn't tell him, I mean, how do you tell your partner that I think I'm dying? You know, I couldn't tell what was going on. And while this was happening, I started to lose weight, because now I'm sick and no appetite. I'm feeling this heat from the back. I was so sick, like I was sick, and I lost weight. I lost like, I think I lost about 10 to 15 kg, and people were starting to talk about me now, the university, because people did not know what was going on. I remember one lady saying, I had rumors, people were saying that she's HIV, this one, you know, definitely it is. So there was a rumor at the university. This is actually my first opportunity, and I thank God for this channel that I'm actually publicly detailing what actually happened to me. I have only the pastors knew, and my friends and my family, but everybody else who wondered what happened to me had no absolute idea what had happened to me actually. So this is the first time I get an opportunity to show, to give this testimony of how God delivered me from the spirit of death that was orchestrated by witches to shorten my destiny that God has placed before me. So the day that I was sick, I was lying down there, I was bedridden. I said, I want to die, you know, and I was getting visions as well, you know, visions of myself in a casket, dead. One day I was sleeping, my tongue was, I dreamt my tongue is like a snake, you know. Also, I remember when I was getting married, there was someone who knew my husband that I did not know my husband. I met my husband in the new church that I'm attending now. And this guy said, you can't marry this young woman. She's a witch. Because one day he was there, you know, they put me on a fast. The church put me on a fast. I used to fast every Friday now to pray. You know, when the pastor was praying with me on that particular Friday, this gentleman was there. And you know how life is, you know, the world is not as so big. I mean, look at the story. This is 2009. I got married to my husband in 2016. You know, and when this incident where I was being prayed for, this gentleman was there. I didn't know that he was connected to my husband. I had no idea. When the pastor was praying for me and he said to me, at that time, it's when the pain, something was moving from the left to the right. He prayed for me and he said to me, when we were praying, he asked me, he said, when I was praying for you, I saw a spiritual snake running away from you. And that's from the day that the pain, this thing of moving stopped. But this this gentleman, when fast forward a few years down the line, 2016, he says to my husband, this woman is a witch, but he didn't know the full story. When my husband's friend at the time, when he told him that, listen, you can't marry this woman, he did not believe the story. And the most beautiful thing about my personality is that I'm very honest at the get-go. Like, when you meet me, there's no two sides. You know, I've heard that there are people that are two-sided. I'm not two-sided. I'm straightforward. I tell it like it is. When he met me, I explained to him that this is my life and this is what I've gone through, at this particular year. And he understood. And I also believe that because when I met my husband, he was an intercessor. He was he's a prayerful person. So because of his prayerful life, I believe that he knew what he was doing. You know, God revealed to him who I was. There were so many things that were said about me, but you know, at the time he was my partner. He still wanted to marry me, and today he's my husband to the glory of God. There was a Friday service at my previous church. Every Friday when they pray, you know, the things of the devil cannot stand the presence of God. Every time they would pray, I will fall down and I'll be delivered. I'll fall down and I'll be delivered. There was just series of deliverance taking place because the enemy had vowed that I want to take this young woman's life. You know, it was just pain after pain. And they advised me to join the intercession and the church to say that, look, you need to build yourself up, not to fight for yourself. And I obeyed because I could see that, you know what, God is not taking my life. I'm still alive today, but I'm faced with this challenge, you know. So I begin to join the church. So every time I'd have pain, like intense pain, I'll try to go to the church. You know, one day I was also in pain. I didn't go to class. So I went to the church and I asked to see the general overseer, you know, and I was lying down on the couch. And I remember the reception saying, there's a young woman who's very sick here. She'd like to see you. You know, I went he said, okay, she can come. I went into his office and he looked at me and he said, what is the issue? I explained to him. The minute also I said to him, I lost about 15 kg. He was like, have you taken an HIV test? And I'm like, the narrative around people being sick and being associated with HIV, it needs to stop, because there's so many things that people go through that affect their weight. You know, being sick and having lost weight has taught me to not even, I really comment about people's weight, because I know that people could be dealing with something. We need to be sensitive around the issue of weight. So he asked me as well, and I was uncomfortable that he would, you know, insinuate along those lines, but I didn't take an offense, because he said something that I carried for since from that day I went to see him. He looked at me and he said, you are not sick. And I was like, okay. He was like, God is training you. You have an anointing. There's an anointing on your life. And I'm like, training, sickness, anointing. How do these things come together? I'm in intense pain. And he prayed with me, but I carried those words. It was like he planted a seed in my spirit. Every time the attack would come, I would arise and I say, I have an anointing. I am gifted. I am called. And I would feel strong and I would start praying. Every time something come, I would say that there's an anointing on my life. I am in training. So my perception around the situation also changed, you know. So eventually I remember they had a huge conference that they organized, their annual conference. There was also this apostle who came, and I'm also grateful that God allowed me to be in that moment. When this apostle came, he picked me from the crowd. He picked me from the crowd and he called me to the front, and I had him pray for me. He said, all of you, come out of her. I felt things leaving me, and I don't know how many were there, but he said, all of you, the spirit of death, he began to address the spirit that were tormenting me, that were given to me through this muti. Just an incident of going to a funeral. I went home well, came back to Joburg, so sick, in excruciating pain, you know, and he called me, he addressed the spirit with power in the name of Jesus, and I felt something come over me. You know, when you see people shake, you know, I know that now people have, you know, done certain things that have diluted, you know, certain powers. There's still power in God. There's still deliverance in God. And today I share the story with the aim to say to somebody that you might be going through something at home and nobody understands you. I advise you to go to a local church that believes in deliverance. Run there and save your life. Don't be afraid of what people will say. People will say that you were Sangoma, they said that. People will say that you are the witch, they said that. But only people that were true men of God tapped into the realm of the spirit, and they were able to pick up that this woman is under an attack. The enemy wanted to shorten her life because of who God has called me to be, you know, on earth, my destiny. They wanted to shorten it, because one thing that as I begin to grow in God, I realized that the reason why this woman wanted to shorten my life, I believe that, you know, witches can see a small glimpse of your future, not the, to its entireness, or what God is taking. So I think she could see that this is who God has called this woman to be. That when she fulfills destiny, a lot of lives are going to be transformed. You know, people are going to come towards Jesus, because in all these things, my aim is to bring glory to the kingdom of God. My aim is to draw people towards God, for souls to be saved. It is not about me, it's about Jesus who saved me. Because there was a time where my mother took me to the doctor, but she was like, you know what, let's try the doctor. You know, the doctor's report was clean. They check everything. I was hot, but he was like, her temperature is normal. Everything is normal. Her blood pressure, her level, everything is normal. So I thought, I knew that, you know what? I am fighting against principalities and, you know, rulers of darkness that needed to be pulled down, you know, with the word of God, that needed to be fought strongly with prayer. And I got the support. So that is why I urge you from home, that you feel like there's something in your tummy, don't take it lightly. That you feel like things are visiting you at night, go to a Bible believing church that will be able to understand your story. They will tap into the realm of the spirit, because nothing happens in the physical until it happens in the realm of the spirit. If you can quickly recall what I said in the beginning, that she gave me, she only spoke a word towards this pup, and there was muti immediately transferred into this pup. So I know that many people don't believe in witchcraft. I guarantee you, for those who want to know more, you know, about my story, and you know, my friends, this is it's a real story. There are many people that say, no, witchcraft does not exist. It exists. And many destinies have been shortened because of people that are evil, that have decided that they will alter, you know, that will alter destinies of the people, of the children of God. You know, last night I was reading the book of Revelation, where I read in the, I think it's 12 or 13, where how the enemy was kicked out of Devon, and the scripture said the enemy was angry, and he said, I will go to earth and with the wrath and cause havoc. So the enemy is at war with us, so we need to plan. But I didn't know all these things until I had to grow. So that day that the apostle prayed for me and he called out all these spirits out of me, I slept peacefully for the very first time in my life. And I remember the following day, I called my mother and I said to her, Mommy, I'm healed. Mommy, I'm healed. And my mother says, I remember that day. She keeps reminding me of it. She's like, what had happened? So I keep telling her that, look, I was at a conference and this is what happened. So my mother keeps telling me, she's like, what had happened? You know, you just called me. And she says, I'll never forget that day, because the day you said, Mommy, I'm healed, they prayed for me and I felt things leave my body. So do not neglect the place of prayer and the place of authority. Spiritual pastors, the right ones that God has ordained, truly they can help you to be delivered while you work with them as well, because you also need to pray. Like I said, I started building up in prayer by being in the intercession, and I was delivered from that spirit, you know. And last year, I was at our church, you know, on the 28th of October. I will never forget this, because it marked a significant day in my life. On the 28th of October, 2020, I had not been going to church through lockdown. On that particular day, I remember saying to my husband that today I feel like going to church. He was like, okay, that's strange, because we've been attending online, you know, virtual, you know, in our church. When they had opened to say people can come, they said a few people can come. Yes. And I said, I feel like going to church today on a Wednesday. And it was like, but it's late. You know, I said, you know, what, I don't know what it is, but today something says to me, go to church. So I went to church, and as soon as I arrived, I sat down for 5 minutes. My pastor calls me. He's like, is that Sikhofatso? And I said, yes. He said, daughter, stand up. And he said, the Lord said you have neglected your ministry. God has called you as an intercessor for the body of Christ. It's almost like I got stuck, because it's like everything that I'd gone through, you know, in my entire life, you know, because also when I got married, I had an ectopic pregnancy, you know, and I was like, God, what's going on? It's almost like I'm moving from series of challenge to challenge to challenge. But everything started to make sense, to say that all these challenges that I have gone through, near-death experiences. I mean, I had 3 near-death experiences. I once drowned in Hardibias. Thank God, you know, the boat driver saw me quickly, and he quickly came and took me out, you know, from the water, and I didn't die, you know. And also the story where the spirit of death was constantly visiting me. I mean, I got sick from 2009 all the way to 2011 when this conference, or 10, towards the end of 10, at this conference when it happened, that's when I got my total deliverance, my total healing. And I've been born again since then, because the power of God. I got healed because the power of God. And my miracle was not instant. And also this mentality where we want to see God heal us, but that's my story. There are people that God will heal instantly, but in my story, it was a story where God trained me how to pray. God trained me and showed me that I am stronger than the challenges that are before me. So the moral of the story is that witchcraft does exist, but so does God as well. God is a powerful God. God is he does not change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. The same God that delivered me from the spirit of death can deliver you as well. So all I wanted to do with this message, with or everything that I've gone through, is to uplift, to encourage somebody. As a result of all these challenges that I've gone through, that the Holy Spirit has inspired me to start my own YouTube channel that I call the Uplifting Hub, where if you want to know more about, you know, the things that I've gone through and how God has delivered me, or you're looking for encouragement, because I understand the issue of witchcraft is an issue of people feel ashamed. You can reach out to me because I have gone through it, and I can direct you to the relevant people that can assist you when you're looking for guidance, that can pray for you and hold your hand. Do not allow the enemy to take advantage of your destiny. There is hope for you in Jesus Christ. There is hope for you in the name of Jesus Christ. Hi, my name is Sikhofatso Tweumbuyamba, and I have been through the most.